Good morning. Can you please greet your seatmate? Good morning. We are now on our series on Practice Radical Love. This part of our core values, and we made an acronym for it, so we already dealt with the book of Jonah as we went through love God, love others. Then right now we are on letter O, obey God's word and authorities. I will be dealing with obey God's word, basically focusing on Numbers chapter 13, which deals with the spies who spied out the promised land. And after the Resurrection Sunday, we will continue with obey the appointed authorities. John chapter 14, verse 15, let's all read it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And Psalm 119, verse 97. Oh, how I love your law, it is my meditation all day. And so that will be more or less the focus of our topic. Let's all bow down our heads for a short word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for your love. And we know that your presence is here with us. We thank you that we have been given this privilege to praise you and worship you, O God. We thank you that somehow we are able to set aside things that may bother us. We pray that we will just focus on your word right now. We ask that you will speak to our individual circumstances. We plead for your mercy and grace to minister to our situations right now, Lord, and we thank you for your graciousness, and we commit you, each and everyone. We believe that your word will truly be a two-edged sword. We also lift up to you Pastor Jess as he's officiating a wedding. We pray for traveling mercies to be with him and Mom Jerry, and we pray that you will just keep them safe, and we pray for their health, and we pray for your anointing upon him in the name of your Son, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Obey God's word. I don't know if you're familiar with Star Trek, this guy. You know. What does it mean when he says that? Live long and prosper. Okay. I realize that indeed, oftentimes we concern ourselves with the blessing of God. And actually this sign comes from the Jewish background of Leonard Nimoy. He's a Jew. And when the rabbi or the Levitical priest would declare the blessing, and they would normally speak the blessing of God written in Numbers chapter 6, verse 24, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Normally, they would do this. Okay, it is a symbol of the symbol used by the rabbi to declare the blessing of God upon the people in the synagogue. And normally, it would simply mean that as he would stretch his hand, the four fingers in each hand are, as they're split in two, it would form the letter Shin. It is an emblem for the Hebrew word Almighty God, Shaddai. And as he does that, it will be like in the form of an overlapping lattice of windows. And this is called the Nesiat Kepayim, the lifting of the hands. And that's exactly what Leonard Nimoy just brought into the movie Star Trek. But oftentimes we don't really understand that God wants to bless us. Okay. Now, I'm not saying that we should address one another and say, you know, live long and prosper. But basically, God wants to bless his people. God wants his power to be manifest in our lives. But oftentimes, the problem is we do not understand that the blessing of God is something that will come upon our lives if we truly not just meditate upon his word, but if we apply his word in our lives. And that's something very clear in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Let's all read it all together. Let's read it aloud. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. And God wants us to have prosperity or success, of course, not in the definition of the world. I think we should put the definitions in accordance to God's word, that prosperity is not just financial, not just material, nor is success something in the area of reaching the peaks of your career or your profession, although that could be part of it. But basically, God wants the fullness of His plans, His programs, and promises upon our life. So can you please whisper to your seatmate, live long and prosper. Of course, according to God's definition. Now, so let's read all together Numbers chapter 13, verse 1 to 2. All together aloud. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, send out for yourself men so that they may spy out the land of Canaan, which I am going to give the sons of Israel. You shall send a man from each of their father's tribes, everyone a leader among them. We will just be skipping this. It's a list of all the tribes of Israel, the leaders. I just want us to focus on two names, Caleb and Joshua. Let's move on to verse 17. All together, aloud please. When Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan, he said to them, go up there into the Negev. Then go up into the hill country. See what the Lord is like, land is like, and whether the people live in it are strong or weak, whether they're few or many. How is the land in which they live? Is it good or bad? How are the cities in which they live? Are they like open camps or with fortifications? How is the land? Is it fat or lean? Are there trees in it or not? Make an effort then to get some of the fruit of the land. Now the time is the time of the first ripe grapes. Then they came to the valley of Eshkol, and from there cut down a branch with a single cluster of grapes. And they carried it on a pole between two men with some of the pomegranates and the figs. That place was called the Valley of Eshkol because of the cluster which the sons of Israel cut down from there. And basically, I want us to focus on the fact that in order to obey God's word, the heart of spying is the key. The heart of spying is the key to obeying God's word. And as we will see in a little while, I'd just like us to mention to your seatmate, you are a spy. Now, of course, the word spy can not just mean spy, it can mean explore, to seek out. But the first thing you would have to understand here is that it is a command. Spying out the promised land was a command by God Himself. He said, he was the one himself who said, that it says that the Lord spoke to Moses, verse 2, send out for yourself that they may spy out the land. And in doing that, it's very important to understand that we are all called to spy out the promised land, to explore, to open our eyes, to see that promised land before us. And it is a responsibility. It is a responsibility, and those who were chosen were leaders of each tribe that they would be representing. They were the leaders, and they were going into this quest to spy out the land, and all of them were heads of the sons of Israel. And basically, I want us to understand that we have this responsibility to spy out the land because we are called by God as those who will spiritually forge ahead into our respective calling, into our respective areas of influence. And I believe that most especially if you're the first Christian in your own family, oftentimes your influence, your leadership to forge ahead in terms of your spiritual influence is called upon and commanded by God. We are to look into these promises, these plans of God that we have for our respective families. And of course, not just our families, but even our communities. Friends, it's very important that we understand that you are a child of God. You have been called by God to be light and salt. You have been called by God to go into His promised land, and where God is placing us, that is exactly where God can bring His promises into our lives. And the question is, do we believe? Do we see God's calling upon our lives? This is a responsibility. And the question is, do we see that this is indeed a very important task for each and every one of us? And as we forge ahead, it is crucial not to just understand the responsibility, but the reason is that so that we will see what the land is like, whether the people who live in it are strong or weak, whether they are few or many. Basically, God wanted an assessment from the faith of Israel, from their experience of what God has been doing in their lives. And as they would go and spy out the land, they would know that, yes, indeed, this is the promised land. But I think it's very important to underscore that it's easier said than done to see the promise of God in our respective circles of influence. Like, for example, in our families, the question is, or in our personal lives, the question is, okay, this is a new lifestyle, a biblical perspective. This is a biblical way of doing things. If you're single, you're thinking in terms of purity. You're thinking in terms of the biblical perspective of living a life for the glory of God. And you ask yourself the question, is this the promised land? Is this something that I can truly hold on to? Is it worth it? Or when we go into our respective offices and we deal with all sorts of things around us in terms of our colleagues, our boss, our subordinates. And we ask that question, are the biblical promises, the biblical perspective, the biblical attitudes, the biblical lifestyle changes, are they something that I can hold on to? Is this something I can rely on? Is it something that is worth following? Is this the promise? And these questions have to be settled, friends, because I like what Peter Forsyth said. Let's all read it all together. The first duty of every soul is to find not its freedom, but its master. And the promised land would only become a promised land if we have truly decided on who our master would be. Who is our master? And so as we realize that this is a command to spy out the promised land of God, to spy out or to open our eyes, to explore, to seek the potential in our respective situations. And bear in mind that we are now bringing in a new heart, biblical attitudes, biblical perspectives, biblical insights, biblical principles, biblical guidelines as we deal with all these circumstances in our work, in our entrepreneurial pursuits, or whether we are into our respective careers or professions, or maybe we're studying in our schools. The question is this the promised land? Is it really going to bring in the prosperity, the success of God's will upon my life? And that is the question we should settle within our hearts. Who is our master? What will determine the decisions I make in life? Another aspect I would like us to focus on is that this is conditional. Depends on how you see things. We're going to spy out the promised land. We're going to look into our various affairs, our various situations, and we must realize that our response to this will now be dependent. It is now conditional on our hearts, our heart attitude. And of course, we will be facing the same facts. We will be facing the same situations. Like in our respective areas of influence, we have this more or less, you know, on different dimensions, we have our challenges. On different aspects, on different sectors, we have our challenges. And the question is, how are we going to react to this? And here we see that the Israelites were practically going from Kadesh Barnea to Lebo Hamath. We have a map describing they're going to the northernmost part of the Promised Land, and then coming back to Kadesh Barnea just to spy out the area. And we noticed that they cut down a branch with a single cluster of grapes, and I've never seen grapes this, you know, this abundant, this lush. I mean, you know, you see the grapes in the groceries, you know, small little pods that would fit into a plastic. And this was a bunch, a cluster of grapes carried by two men over a pole. And they had to, you know, have you seen a cluster of grapes when it needs two men to carry it? I don't think so. That's how, you know, that's how fertile the place was. And the question in life is, we are seeing these things. They bring this word back to the congregation. They show them the fruit of the land, but it now depends on how they will perceive it. And they actually said it, you know, it certainly does flow with milk and honey. But the question is, what was their reaction to this? You know the story, you have an idea, but I'd just like us to understand that in any given situation, let's all read it together. In any given situation, what you are determines what you see. What you see determines what you do. Or as Antoine de Saint-Exupéry would say, his much quoted saying, that what is essential is invisible to the eye. It is only with the heart that we can see clearly. What is essential is actually invisible to the eye. And that's the point. We have our same, you know, more or less relative situations, different aspects of emphasis. We have challenges in our physical lives. We have challenges in our family lives. We have challenges in our workplace. Challenges all over the place. Each and everyone, we have our special situation. Question is, what do we see? Do we see the promise? Or do we see pestilence? Do we see the power of God? Or do we see that which will hinder the power of God? How did the spies, the 10 spies, respond? They were filled with fear. Look at those words. Nevertheless, moreover. Let's read the whole verse all together aloud, please. Nevertheless, the people who live in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Two words. Even in the Hebrew, they are in the negative. It means the dearth. Mas malalim pa ho sa kaso, yan sa ating si kaso, although meron ng hint of negativity. Kaso, okay. The land, the people are strong. The cities are fortified. Moreover, idagdag mo pa the descendants of Anak there. Filled with fear. Fear has nothing to do with sheer courage. Fear has something to do with our spiritual conditions. The people who live in the land are strong. The cities are fortified. Descendants of Anak, Amalek, Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites, Canaanites are all over the place. And when you look at this, they have forgotten something very important. These are just tribes. These are just tribes. They came from Egypt. God practically delivered them from Egypt. It was the greatest empire during that time. The greatest empire. What are these tribes compared to the greatest empire during that time? God delivered them. But they could not see that. They were filled with fear. Can you please tell your seatmate? Your giants are just tribes. Your giants are just tribes. I mean, look into the history. Israel was delivered out of Egypt. They were living in slavery, oppression. They were being killed. Their children are being slaughtered. And God delivered them from the greatest empire at that point in time. The hegemony of Egypt then was something to behold. And yet God destroyed one empire. And they crossed the Red Sea. I mean, that is probably one of the most spectacular miracles in terms of its physicality. Walking through dry land, a pile of water on the left, pile of water on the right, and I don't know if they could see the fish, the huge fish on the left and on the right. I don't know what they actually saw. Maybe they were throwing stones at the water. Totoo ba to? You know? So when you consider all of these things, you know that you notice that fear takes away the reasoning. Fear takes away the logic of faith. Fear takes away that which is actually the reality. Because these are just tribes. I don't know what you're going through, friends. I don't know what challenges you face. I'm not saying they're easy. But I just want us to be reminded that they're just tribes. God has brought us through the signs and wonders. He has delivered us from Egypt itself. Our sinfulness, our slavery to sin, our slavery to vice, our slavery to a secular worldview, our slavery to all these fears, our slavery to all these sinful lifestyles, this immorality, this self-willed attitude, this pride, all these enslavement that we have been through, God has delivered us. We have experienced His power. We have seen signs and wonders in our lives. But the question is, do we remember? And I think that's something very crucial to underscore. And so the Israelites gave a bad report of the land which they had spied out. They exaggerated everything. It is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great size. The Nephilim, the sons of Anak, are part of the Nephilim, and we became like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight. And friends, even archaeology right now proves that skeletal remains or fossilized skeletons were already discovered, and indeed they were reaching those heights. But despite that, we must be reminded that they're just tribes. God has delivered us from Egypt. God has brought us out of darkness into light. As we trust in Jesus Christ, as we have forsaken our path of sinfulness, God has delivered us. And oftentimes, as we face the challenges ahead of us, as we face these problems, these situations in our workplace, oftentimes it's so easy to doubt and forget that God has delivered us. I think that's very important, because oftentimes the reason is we doubt God's love. Let's all read this. To examine carefully and constantly what that one thing in me is which causes me in the least to doubt the love of God, and so direct all my forces against it. Friends, once we doubt the love of God, we doubt the concern of God for us, we start to be filled with fear. And that's exactly what we see in the response of Israel. We see them responding with fear. Why? They forgot the love of God. All throughout the years, leaving Egypt, crossing the Red Sea, signs and wonders, miracle after miracle after miracle. Some of those miracles, I don't think we will ever see in history afterwards. And yet, they forgot all of that. They doubted God simply because they doubted the love of God. And this was so contagious. All the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. Can you imagine the contagion of this attitude of having no faith? Can you please tell your seatmate, you're contagious. Whether positively or negatively. You're contagious. Your faith or lack of it can affect us. I think that's very important to understand. That's what fear does. Takes away hope. Takes away that trust in the love of God. They grumbled against Moses and Aaron. Actually, they were grumbling against God. And they said, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. And you notice, you didn't die. That's the point. You didn't die. God preserved you out of Egypt, preserved you through the wilderness. You didn't die. But you notice, they were fixated on the giants. They were fixated on the tribes. They forgot that they were delivered from an empire. The greatest empire at that point in time in history. And I think that's very important to underscore, friends. As we face our physical challenges, let's not forget, God's faithful. Easier said than done. Yes, it's not easy. We go through these financial situations. Yes, it's not easy. Been there, seen it, done that. We forget. And I think that's very important to understand. We must not forget. We must not allow this amnesia to creep in. We must not allow this forgetfulness to creep in. Let us constantly remember. And time again, you've heard me share miracles that I've experienced in my life. And I think we all have our miracle. Or rather, miracles. Okay? Please ask your seatmate, what's your miracle? What's your miracle? I wish we had the time to share how God delivered us from financial Egypt. How God delivered us from physical Red Seas. Physical ailments akin to the Red Sea. Cancer. Story after story. We have our own miracles, friends. Let's not forget. Can you ask your seatmate, do you have amnesia? May amnesia sa utang. Huwag natin kalimutan po. Let us not forget that God has delivered and will continue to deliver. And it goes on and on. I think it just escalates. It just escalates. They didn't just stop in focusing on the tribes, the giants. They didn't just stop on these things. They escalate. Now they're thinking of going back to Egypt. They're thinking of appointing another leader, blaming the Lord that they would fall. They were so afraid that they would fall by the sword. Their wives, their little ones will become plunder. Better to return to Egypt. That's exactly what they were. They were plunder. They were slaves. They were oppressed. Their children were slaughtered. And they want to go back. It's just like going back to your addiction to a vice. It's just like going back to your addiction to a certain lifestyle. Going back to that emptiness. Going back to that decadent living. Going back to those disappointing and frustrating lifestyles. And I think that's something we must always remember, friends. Fear can do this. Let us not forget. And finally, they were threatening to stone the leaders with stones. And I think that's very important to underscore, friends. What are we looking at? It is only with a heart that we see rightly. What is essential is invisible. I think that's something very important to underscore. Every time I go through tough times, I just remember one story wherein it's not as fantastic as my half a million credit card getting paid by God. You all heard that story. Credit card just got paid in an instant when my realtor friend called me and said, "Pastor, let's meet up. Remember you introduced me to this realtor who was looking for a property, and so the deal went through and your commission is about $800,000. You heard that story, but I have a smaller story, but it's more fantastic. My third daughter was around 1 year old, and she was already weaned from breast milk, and so we needed to buy the usual formula, baby formula for her. But at that time, that day, I didn't have money, not a cent. So I went to the ATM, you know, hoping that there would be some fantastic miracle, you know, someone deposited. Woo! Praise God. But there was none. Looked into the ATM and there's none. So it's like one of those dramatic moments when you sort of hear this violin playing. Kawawa ka naman, Bibo. You know? Gulong ng palad ang buhay. Parang you hear this, you know. I was still starting out in the ministry back then, you know. Birth pangs. And I was walking away from the ATM, feeling, you know, down, and, you know, I was looking down, and lo and behold, 300 pesos right there in front. And there was no one on the street. Honest, no kidding aside. Baka akala nyo, may tao dun. Uy, baka, hindi. No. There was no, it was 11 p.m. and I saw 300 right there. My daughter will not be crying the whole night looking for milk. Maybe we're going through a sickness. Maybe we're going through financial difficulty. Or maybe it's a relationship that's falling apart. Maybe the challenge is with our spouse or with our children or with our parents, or maybe in school, or probably your boss is threatening to fire you, or maybe the business is on the verge of collapse. I don't know what your giant is. I don't know what your challenge is, friends, but there is one thing I have to be reminded myself personally, and like all of us, let us be reminded that these are just tribes. Jesus Christ has conquered the Egypt. the empire. Jesus has conquered. And we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. At this point, Moses steps in, prays and intercedes for this, the disobedience of this people. He pleads, Lord, do not destroy this people. Nevertheless, God's wrath is poured out. But let's go to that later. I think very important to understand that we need a faith-filled response. A faith-filled response to this situation. Yes, it is a conditional situation. How are we going to respond? With fear or with faith? And so Caleb quieted the people before Moses. He said, we should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it. Beautiful statement. He didn't say, maybe we might, maybe, could be possible, you know. The risks and the possibilities are on our, you know. He didn't say that. He was not, you know, hesitant. He was not doubtful. He clearly said, we will surely overcome. Can you whisper to your seatmate? You will surely overcome. Look at his perception. The land which we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. Friends, do we see this? Do we see the goodness of God? Do we see the potential of our situation in our community, in our domestic situations? Do we see that potential with our spouse? Or do we only see negativity? Do we only see the faults, the imperfections? Are we fixated on God's promise? We look at our children and that's a question. Do we only see their present imperfections and we're not looking farther on? Or maybe our boss, he's really making it so difficult for us. Threatening to fire us or threatening to demote us. Can we still see that this is an exceeding good land? Business, the same thing. Do we have that faith as Joshua and Caleb had? And they were exuberant about the place. They said, he will bring us into this land. Let's all read this. He will bring us into this land and give it to us. A land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord. Do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. As in most invasions, history clearly gives us some facts that many of the plagues that hit the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, many of those sicknesses came ahead before Israel arrived. And so God was actually fighting for them. God was able, God was moving. Their protection has been removed. The Lord is with us. Do not fear the tribes. I think that's very important to understand, friends. Are we fixated on God's promised land? Do we see the potential? Let's all read this quote. It says, faith is reason gone courageous. Not the opposite of reason, to be sure, but something more than reason, and never satisfied by reason alone. A step always remains beyond the range of light. There's no such thing as covering all the bases in life, friends. Yes, as much as possible, let's cover all the bases. Let's do our organizing, our preparations in whatever endeavor we have, whether it's domestic, whether it's work-related, whether it's business, whether it's with regard to our careers. Yes, but finally, there is a point wherein you have to walk by faith. There are certain things that goes beyond the range of light. We cannot see everything to its final end. We just have to walk by faith. It is God's call to each and every one of us to spy out the land. And I think that's very important. And the last thing I would like us to focus on is the fact that there are consequences. As we spy out the promised land, there are positive or negative consequences, and we will see that in the following verses. And finally, the Lord, let's all read verse 20. So the Lord said, I have pardoned them according to your word, but indeed, as I live, all the earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord. Surely all the men who have seen my glory and my signs, which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not listened to my voice, shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who spurned me see it, but my servant Caleb, because he has had a different spirit and has followed me fully. I will bring into the land which he entered, and his descendants shall take possession of it. And so here we understand something very important. After Moses pleads to the Lord that he would, you know, relent from destroying Israel, he was, you know, giving God the scenario that the Egyptians will spurn and they will scorn and they will say, oh, God wasn't able to bring his people into the promised land. He slaughtered them in the wilderness. And with that argument, God, you know, sort of just delayed his judgment. But definitely that generation, the generation that saw the plagues in Egypt, the generation that crossed the Red Sea, the generation that experienced signs and wonders, miracle after miracle after miracle, they would not enter the promised land. That was the consequence. They put God to the test, and that was his judgment. They shall by no means see the land. And friends, oftentimes we forget that there are consequences. When we do not step out in faith, when we do not believe that this new biblical lifestyle is indeed that which will bring us into the fullness of God's promises, when we do not believe that and we violate those principles, we face the consequences. And that's exactly what we see here. They would not see the promised land. And God even promised that their corpse will fall in this wilderness. So can you imagine if you're talking about around 2 million people and the first generation would be killed in the wilderness? You're talking about a burial service every day for the next 40 years just to finish off the first generation. And so the business of burying would be booming, you know, all throughout that time in the wilderness. Their judgment was going to be certain. In 40 years, that entire generation. It said, all your numbered men, according to your complete number, from 20 years old and upward, would be killed. So if you're 20 years old upward, no, I'm just kidding. But that's what we see here, friends. Because that generation saw the power of God. They experienced the deliverance from Egypt. But as many commentators say, they left Egypt, but Egypt never left their hearts. Left Egypt, but Egypt never left their hearts. A sad commentary. But these are the consequences. But as for Caleb and Joshua, they would enter the promised land. they would see the glory of God. They would see the power of God in their lives. And I think that's very important. And you will notice that God was so emphatic. He said, your children, however, whom you said would become prey, I will bring them in. And they will know the land which you have rejected. Inulit naman niya. Patay kayo. Your corpse will fall in the wilderness. Inulit naman ng Lord. Your dead meat. And oftentimes that is what happens when we disobey. There are consequences. Of course, in a time of grace, in this dispensation of grace, God, in a sense, has been more gracious. And I think that's very important to understand. Let us not wait for the patience of God to run out. Let us not constantly harden our hearts. Let us not constantly, you know, rebel against God. Let us not constantly, veer away from the path of the Word of God. Because even in the New Testament, there is a thing called sin unto death. And I think it's very important to realize that there will be consequences. In fact, even their sons, they will be shepherds for 40 years in the wilderness, and they will suffer for your unfaithfulness, as God said, until your corpse lie in the wilderness. Inulit na naman ng Lord. You know. And it said, you shall bear your guilt a year, even 40 years, and you will know my opposition. And of course, we know the rest of the story. Immediately, those who were spying out the land and reported negatively died by a plague. But Joshua and Caleb, they remained alive and they entered the promised land. And I like what C.S. Lewis said. Let's all read it. You never know how much you really believe anything until its truth or falsehood becomes a matter of life and death to you. Friends, do we truly believe that the Word of God is the Word of God? Is it just a set of advice? A set of inspirational material? Or is it the Word of God? Is it something that we can hold on to as we go through the challenges ahead? I remember when God opened a way for us to open work in Basilan. How many of you have been to Basilan? One, Basilan, two, three or four, about five people. Yeah. Basilan is a beautiful place. Beautiful, you know. Natural resources, beautiful. And I remember when I went there around 1990s, we rode a small boat, and this boat was filled, half of the boat was filled with Marines, you know. And the Marine soldiers, they really look different, you know. They're not the usual, you know, the usual soldiers you see here, the army. They carry this, long firearms, you know, but different, you know. They had their backpacks. They had this crisscross of, you know, bullet. They had grenades hanging in front of them. You want to pluck it out, you know. And it was a very uneasy situation, you know, riding with them on the boat. And as we arrived in Basilan, we started opening the work there, and the church there just told me stories after stories. I would go back and forth every now and then during the 1990s, and one day I heard that one of their members was decapitated, beheaded rather. You know, and when this was happening, I was just asking God, Lord, you are the God who delivered us from Egypt. These are just tribes. And Lord, I would just pray for his protection, not just upon myself, but upon the people. Because it was a very difficult situation. One time, a bomb exploded and the windows of the center there, just everything was shattered. And time again, God would always remind me that he will never leave me. He will never forsake me. And the question is the Word of God really something I can hold on to? Should I stand on the Word? Should I obey God's Word for me? That he has called me to bring the gospel, to share the gospel, to equip a church so that they would be able to respond with the gospel to their situation, to their surroundings. And I think that's something very important, friends, because it only becomes truth when it is a matter of life and death. And I think that's something very important to realize. Even Joshua, as they entered the promised land, it says here that just as the Lord had commanded Moses, his servant, so Moses commanded Joshua, and so Joshua did. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord had commanded Moses. Joshua was so consistent, even up to the point that Moses was dead. He was now leading Israel. He was consistently obeying the word of God. And even Caleb, he said, I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land, and I brought word back to him as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me made the heart of the people melt with fear, but I followed the Lord my God. And so we know the rest of the story, the promises of God that he gave to Joshua and Caleb were actually fulfilled. They were able to get the inheritance that God promised them. And so Moses, it says here in verse 9, Moses warned that they, surely the land on which your foot has trodden will be an inheritance to you and to your children forever, because you have followed the Lord my God fully. And what was their age? 85 years old. At that point in time, they were still fighting warriors in the thick of conquering the promised land. And I'd just like us to read verse 11. It says, I am still as strong today as I was in the day Moses sent me. As my strength was then, so my strength is now for war and for going out and coming in. I think that's very important, friends. He will conquer these giants. If God has given us the deliverance from Egypt, definitely we will conquer these giants by the grace of God. Let's all stand up at this moment. I think more than anything, let's be reminded that obeying God is not something that we can do on our own. We need to understand that we are unable, because of our sinful nature, we are unable to obey God's word. And that sinfulness within our hearts makes us not just weak, but it makes us constantly failing his word. And that's why we understand that Jesus Christ gave his life on that cross on Calvary. And let's be reminded that it is only Jesus who can do this in us. If we will repent from sin, if we will turn away from sin, if we will just realize our need for a Savior, for forgiveness, and receive what Jesus has done on that cross on Calvary. When that criminal beside Jesus asked him, requested him and said, Lord, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. Jesus promised him and said, today you will be with me in paradise. And that's exactly the promise that we would like each and everyone to have. If we would receive Jesus into our hearts, if he would live into our hearts, if we would believe by faith in what he has done for us on that cross in Calvary, as he dwells in our heart, he gives us the heart that will obey his word. Father, we know that we have failed you many times. We have doubted you many times, Lord. We know that as we faced the giants, as we confront these tribes, as we encounter the giants in our physical ailments, forgive us, Lord, that we have doubted your power. As we face the giants of our financial situations, the giants of our needs, material needs, difficulties, Lord, we ask, Lord, forgive us for doubting you. As we face the giants in our offices, the giants of the leaders and masters over us, or the giants that we face with our colleagues or subordinates, forgive us, Lord, that we have doubted you. Lord, as we face the giants in our entrepreneurial pursuits, Father, forgive us that we have doubted you. Even with our domestic situations, our spouse, our parents, our children, our siblings, forgive us, Lord, if we have doubted you. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us that no matter how tall these giants are, no matter how formidable their cities are, no matter how fortified the cities are that we are facing, no matter how numerous the enemies are, remind us, O God, that you have defeated Egypt, the greatest empire. You have defeated sin. You have conquered sin. You have delivered us from slavery to fear, slavery to doubt. You have delivered us from slavery to an immoral lifestyle. You have delivered us from slavery to vices. You have delivered us, O God, from slavery to pride, slavery to materialism, Lord. You have delivered us from Egypt, O Lord, and we believe that these tribes are nothing compared to what you have done in our lives. Father, as we forge forward, as we explore the land that you are giving us, as we spy out the land that you are giving us, Father, may we see the fullness of your plans. May we truly see your power, because you have conquered, you have occupied these territories. Therefore, Lord Jesus, we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And Father, we commit to you our situations, and we know that you will provide, O God. We know, Lord God, that you will bring healing upon us, O Lord. We believe your power will move in a special way. Lord, we know that you will bring peace and harmony in our relationships, O God. And we know that by the power of Jesus, we will enter the promised land. We believe in your goodness and your faithfulness. Lord, we remember that you love us. We will consciously, intentionally remember your love for us, your concern for us. We will intentionally remember your words, your promises. We will intentionally remember how you delivered us from Egypt, how we conquered, Lord God, by your grace, how we crossed the Red Sea, how we experienced signs and wonders, how we saw you deliver us. We thank you, Lord, that we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And Lord, we just believe in your power and grace. We commit to you our individual households. We commit to your families. We commit to you our workplace, Father. We commit to you our schools, Lord. We believe that nothing is too difficult with you. And we thank you, Lord, that we will enter the promised land and you will conquer for us. Thank you, Father. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you.